Welcome to the broadcast tonight, a conversation about Iraq with David Rieff and Fouad Ajami, both recently been there.
Obviously, things are worse in Baghdad and in the so-called Sunni triangle than in the rest of the country. But it is not the case that these things couldn't have been predicted. We have a history of thinking about these issues. 10 years of post-Cold War peacekeeping operations, a huge body of knowledge, people who commanded units, people who commanded in Bosnia, in Kosovo, in Haiti, they all say the American plan was fouled up.
No one has answered fully whether there is a single Iraq, whether Iraq really exists. No one has answered it, to my satisfaction. Maybe we will not succeed. So instead of saying we should have stood there and guarded the museum and so on, we have to look at Iraq itself. Perhaps the difficulty of the American mission is that we face a society that was wounded at its core, and that it's not really a single national society, but perhaps three different states.
Also this evening, the great banjo artist, Bela Fleck.
There's something about it. The sound is a very interesting sound. I think it's like kind of high-tech and primitive at the same time. You know what I mean? So if you hear it, it's...
Speaking like of the Beverly Hillbillies,
yeah. Yeah, and so it's like there's speed and there's this technical stuff, but there's also this earthy quality. So I don't know, it's an interesting combination.
A program note, Martin Amis, the English novelist, was scheduled to be on tonight's program. We recorded a terrific conversation with him. We'll show it to you at a later date. Tonight, Iraq and Bela Fleck, when we continue. Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
Coca-Cola and our local bottlers have sponsored more than 4,000 scholars, like Matthew Turner, helping them to attend college and prepare for careers that benefit all of us, satisfying a thirst for achievement, the Coca-Cola Company.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
November has been the bloodiest month for U.S. forces in Iraq since the end of the military operations in that country. Forced to deal with this crisis, the Bush administration then moving up its timetable for the transfer of power to the Iraqis. Earlier today, President Bush spoke to reporters.
What I'm interested in doing is working with Ambassador Bremer and the Governing Council to work on a plan that will encourage the Iraqis to assume more responsibility. Ambassador Bremer sat right here yesterday and talked to me about the Iraqis' desire to be more involved in the governance of their country. And that's a positive development, because precisely that's what we want. We want the Iraqis to be more involved in the governance of their country. And so Ambassador Bremer, with my instructions, is going back to talk to the Governing Council to develop a strategy. And he'll report back after he's consulted with the very people that we want to assume more responsibility.
Joining me now is David Rieff. His article, Who Botched the Occupation? Blueprints for a Mess, appeared in the November 2nd issue of the New York Times Magazine. Also here is Fouad Ajami. He is Director of Middle East Studies at the School for Advanced International Studies at Johns Hopkins University, also a contributing editor of U.S. News and World Report, and a consultant for CBS News. He, too, recently visited Iraq. I'm pleased to have both of them at this table.
Thank you
both for coming. I said to you before that having been away from this table for a while, knowing that you both had been there, knowing that going in you had different perspectives on the wisdom of going to Iraq, and having been there now, how you see things. And let me begin with you, David. You went there. Your piece is called Who Botched the Occupation.
Yeah, I guess that makes it fairly clear
what I
think of the post-war. Look, I don't think one's opinions about the post-war have all that much to do with whether one was for the war or not.
I don't either.
I don't see why.
And I don't think they prove too much in terms of what people said before the war.
No, I mean, the rightness of, you could be, I was not for the war, but you certainly could be for the war and judge the occupation harshly. The question of the occupation is, to a very large extent, a question of how you evaluate American preparedness for what came after. And I think we were shockingly, miserably unprepared. And that would be forgivable because, as many administration spokesmen have said, war, you know, no plan survives the first battle. Were it not for the fact that there was a lot of planning done by the State Department before the war that was simply thrown out by the Pentagon in the immediate run-up to the war. I'm referring particularly to something called the Future of Iraq Project. But also that the military, and this to me is actually the more serious part of the indictment against the administration, the military did not get the orders to train for the post-war. I have gone through after-action report after after-action report of the units that spearheaded our drive from Kuwait to Baghdad. And what they say is, we won this war, and they won it brilliantly. I mean, Saddam Hussein's army may not have been the most powerful thing on earth, but still to win it as decisively, quickly, and efficiently as they did is a remarkable military accomplishment. They won it, they say, thanks to the training they did before. Then when you get to the very end of these reports, it says, oh, and incident, we had no training whatsoever and no orders from higher authority for what to do after the war. So, you know, I think it has been botched. It has. That doesn't mean it's hopeless, but it's been botched.
Hopeless comes as another, we'll get to that later, and we'll get to what ought to be done. In terms of the botching of the reconstruction, right, or the occupation.
Well, I'm not that judgmental, by the way, of the results on the ground. And I should begin by just saying something to you, Charlie, about what you come back from Iraq with, above all, is the genuine sense of awe and love, almost, for these young men and women you meet in Iraq. I mean, this American truth. If we be Rome, these are our centurions out there. And when you go to Kuwait and you fly from Kuwait, from these bases to Iraq, and this military take you, and you realize that the boy with the atop the Humvee with the machine gun, nicely flagging and asking the drivers in Kirkuk to slow down and let us go, and when you realize that these helicopter crews who are keen to strap you in your seat because you're too incompetent to strap yourself in your seat, there, when you realize these are 19 and 20 year old kids, there's a kind of sense of awe of this, and this kind of American helicopters and the palm trees below. There is something very awesome about this. We've taken America's truth to a very difficult country, and I don't think any plan would have survived what we found there. I don't think we had any idea what Saddam had done to that country. We had no idea what we would find. We know all sorts of things, just little pieces that we can put on the table, and then we can analyze them. The man Saddam releases 100,000 prisoners, 75,000 of them are killers, rapists, arsonists, etc. They're there waiting for us when we arrive. We discover that, for example, there was no water, no running water in Basra, because Saddam preferred to truck the water in so that everyone would be dependent on his largesse and he could punish the people he wanted to punish. And when we discover this kind of poisoned society, this despotic tradition, and when we discover that the Sunni Arab ruling elite had governed the country as a private possession and had poisoned the place, we arrived there in the midst of all this. Were we innocent? Of course we were. Did we know enough about Iraq? Of course we didn't. Did anyone know enough about Iraq? Did the Arabs right next door to Iraq know much about Iraq? They really didn't. So we arrived there. And like I said, our truth is redeemed by these young centurions there. And by and large, maybe our truth. I mean, the American idea and the American mission. I mean, we went to Iraq for all kinds of good reasons, and we can go back and review them. But, you know, my own sense is that maybe we have not been brilliant on the ground, but the task was monumental. The task was monumental. There is a big difference, and I'll stop there, between the skill of the military in Iraq and the relative incompetence of the civilians who are in Iraq trying to run this occupation. We are not good at this.
Is that Bremer and people like that, or is it?
No, it's the fact that in the 90s, we were not the 90s. We were not into imperial power. We did not know that we would be visited by the furies of the Islamic world. We didn't know that the boys of September 11 would come our way. The cream of our youth were in business schools, and everyone was fixated on the NASDAQ. Our whole culture was not prepared for the kind of work that awaited us in Iraq. No one was prepared for the kind of work that awaited us in Iraq. And the spin of the State Department, oh, you know, we had a great plan, but it's the Pentagon who did this to us, it's childish in the extreme. This is a very silly bureaucratic argument. There is no truth in it. There is no truth in it. I haven't seen much in the State Department, much wisdom about Iraq or about the Arab. There is an Arabist truth in the State Department, and it probably colored what kind of thoughts they had about Iraq. But I think David is right in the sense on the quotation he had, that no plan will survive the first battle. And I don't think anyone's plan would have been brilliant.
Having listened to both of you, notwithstanding what you just said, I think you two see it dramatically different.
We do. Because, I mean, leaving us, there are lots of things to say in response to what Fouad has said. Notably, if these centurions are as able and as noble as he says they are, we cannot logically have had the cream of our youth in business schools in the 1990s. That's just a romantic fallacy, because these people didn't come out of military school yesterday. They were trained in the American Army in the 1990s. So I have to say, this all gets awfully romantic for me and awfully metaphorical.
Well, I'm very romantic about what I saw there, but you're also
talking about something that I think makes a lot of Americans, including me, very uncomfortable, which are words like centurion and the new Rome. I think one can agree and believe that we have to fight terrorism and strike back at the Furies, there I'll follow you in your metaphors, that struck us on September 11th, without being at all comfortable with the idea that it is time for us to be the new Romans, be the new centurions, or get involved in any of that stuff, which for me is the last place the American Republic should be going. To get back to the specifics, I have to say, when you say there's no truth in the State Department, there's lots of truth in the State Department. There's a 13-volume Future of Iraq report that anyone can read. It was leaked to the New York Times. It exists. It is very detailed. It, among other things, predicted the looting. You say, you know, when you say no one could have predicted this and agree with me, when in fact I was, of course, quoting an administration official with whom I don't agree, about how no plan survives the battle. The fact of the matter is, the issue of looting absolutely is something that was predictable, and we screwed it up. Our troops, having conquered Baghdad, stood around without orders while ministries were burned and ill will was created. Let me give you just one example. It's often said by American officials, we protected the oil ministry. This, of course, is this controversial matter that anti-American people raise, and they say, you know, you protected the oil ministry, but you didn't protect anything else. And American officials answer that very ineptly, because they are, largely speaking, inept in the way they've replied to critics. They say, well, we couldn't protect everything. The truth of the matter is the oil ministry is in the middle of a whole neighborhood of ministries. In order to get to the oil ministry to protect it, you had to go past other burning ministries. So the idea, it's simply a lie, or it's ignorance. I can only hope it's ignorance on the part of U.S. officials when they say that. Similarly, as Faisal Istrabadi, a member of the Future of Iraq Project, a man I talked to a lot for this report, an advisor to Adnan Pachachi, one of the exile leaders, as he put it, what was all this about not being able to protect the National Museum? There are signs in English in Baghdad leading to Museum Square and the National Museum. The reason these things didn't happen was because the military had no orders. Now, you can't tell me that's the fog of battle. That's a decision, and a wrong decision, and a decision, at least in Baghdad. I quite agree things are better in the north. Nobody disagrees with that, although they're not as better in the north as they used to be, as events unravel in Mosul.
Or in the south. Either.
And in the south now. But let's say, obviously, things are worse in Baghdad and in the so-called Sunni Triangle than in the rest of the country. But it is not the case that these things couldn't have been predicted. We have a history of thinking about these issues. 10 years of post-Cold War peacekeeping operations, a huge body of knowledge, people who commanded units, people who commanded in Bosnia, in Kosovo, in Haiti, they all say the American plan was fouled up.
Well, you know, this business, we go back to the museum. I mean, the museum is really amazing. People have spent so much time talking about the museum. And what's interesting about the museum, that a lot of people who talk about the museum haven't talked about the mass graves that were found in Iraq. I mean, I find this, the fascination with the museum to be the centerpiece of the opposition to the war. And you say that the museum proves our abdication in Kirkuk. There was a man who had this kind of wise way about him. And I asked him a question just simply about looting. I said, who looted? And he had this, you know, weary look and said, everybody looted. Now, the idea that everybody would loot, the idea that we had to expect that everybody would loot, I mean, that's a remarkable idea.
Everybody looted in Panama. Right. Everybody looted in Haiti. The American forces, commanded by General William Nash, whom I believe you've had on this show from time to time, in Bosnia, were prepared for looting. I mean, the point I'm making here, Fouad, is not to re-argue the justice of the war. I intentionally started our conversation trying to veer away from that. I mean, if you really want me to engage you on the subject of whether the war is right or wrong, I'm willing to. But I'm not one of the people who uses the museum as an example of what was wrong with the war. I'm one of the people who uses the museum as an example of what was completely fouled up, botched, ill-prepared in a completely unnecessary way about the occupation.
You have to ask this question about your thesis. How much of it was because it was fouled up, and how much of it was simply because that circumstances there were much worse than they expected, in terms of the infrastructure, partly, in terms of the capacity of the Iraqis to want to take part when Saddam was not captured?
The first thing, I don't think the capture of Saddam is going to change everything. I wish I did, but I don't believe it for a second, and neither does General Abizaid, our commander of CENTCOM.
Who had a press conference
today. Yeah, who had a press conference basically saying he didn't believe that was going to put an end to everything. I don't know a single American, serious American commander who believes the capture of Saddam Hussein is going to put an end to this.
Okay, but I'm going to interrupt you again. Here's my issue, what I'm trying to understand. They botched it up because they didn't follow a State Department plan, this sort
of plan. Well, for example,
if they had done that, everything would have been fine, and we would be looking at a circumstance.
David, let me interrupt you this. You've had plenty of run. Now, this quoting of Adnan Pachaj. This deference to Adnan Pashashi is very interesting. Look, he's a member of the governing council. Now, he has been quoted to me by many people saying that thanks to the Americans, they have brought us the Ajam. You know what the Ajam mean? The Ajam means the Persians. You know what the Persians mean? In the Iraqi context, means the Shia. So therefore, this idea, you know, taking the verdict, taking these testimonies without really...
No, I'm taking the testimony of a respected Iraqi-American. You want to fight the Shia-Sunni thing at this table. I'm not going to fight it with you.
The Sunni-Shia thing is at the heart of the matter. For example, instead of taking a look at what did we botch and what didn't we botch, we never anticipated, of course, and this is an interesting question, if we really want to go at the heart of the matter, we did not anticipate this revolution, this revolt, this ferocious response from the so-called Sunni triangle. We didn't anticipate it.
Well, then the question, though, David might ask of you, should we have anticipated it?
Well, look, there were people, Charlie, who were spending a lot of time...
Did we think it would... Go ahead.
There were people spending a lot of time worrying about the Shia in Iraq. There were people convinced, of course, that the Shia were bent on creating a republic in Iran's image. And we spent enormous amount of time, myself included, other people included, debating what the Shia will do in the aftermath of the toppling of the regime. It turned out we face a huge problem, and we faced it in the Sunni triangle, and we know what we are facing in the Sunni triangle. We have a full insurgency of a people who are used to ruling. And what you have is three tributaries of this in the Sunni triangle. You have the local tribal rebellion against the outsiders. Then you have these former regime loyalists, the remnants of the old regime, coming back to Fallujah and Tikrit because there is nothing that they can do in the rest of the country. Then you have these jihadists who have come to the Sunni triangle and have used the mosques and have used the resentments of the Sunni triangle against this new order. Now, what could you do? No one has answered fully. No one has answered fully whether there is a single Iraq, whether Iraq really exists. No one has answered it, to my satisfaction. Maybe we will not succeed. So instead of saying we should have stood there and guarded the museum and so on, we have to look at Iraq itself. Perhaps the difficulty of the American mission is that we face a society that was wounded at its core, and that it's not really a single national society, but perhaps three different states.
Let me come in to give you, I interrupted you and kept you from having an opportunity to go along the line in pursuit of this question. Was it, take this example from the New York Times today, the recent string of high-profile attacks on U.S. and allied forces in Iraq has appeared to be so methodical and well-crafted that some top U.S. commanders now fear that maybe the war Saddam Hussein and his generals planned all along. I mean, what
tick off for me, beyond the museum, you know, the critical mistakes that we have made that lead us to where we are? And was it because, in your judgment, bad intelligence? Was it, as Newsweek magazine suggests, how Dick Cheney sold the war, the inside story, why he fell for bad intelligence and pitched it to the president?
Well, listen, I think any American has to say this war was presented. Perhaps some people in the administration didn't really mean it when it was presented this way, but this war was presented as being about weapons of mass destruction, and no weapons of mass destruction have been found. So if that's not bad intelligence, I don't know what is. Vice President Cheney's role, I'm not competent to judge. I don't know the man. I know rumor and innuendo, and I'm not particularly interested in passing judgment. I'll tell you this, it's not just about the museum. It's a whole attitude. The city of Baghdad was looted to the point that it was literally unrecognizable. You can talk, I've written a lot about sanctions, and I went to Iraq very early after the war to try to understand what Iraqis thought about sanctions. I went all over the country. Having said that, it wasn't just a question of looting municipal buildings or looting supermarkets. It was a question, for example, of looting hospitals. It was a question of looting pretty much everything that went while American troops stood by. And that's the essential part. Look, I'm not focused on the museum. The museum, I rather agree with Fouad. I think the museum is often used polemically in a case against the war. But there was no reason, on the basis of doctrine or anything else, to have stood by in that way, point one. Point two, the administration either lied to the public or was genuinely convinced, I have no view on this subject, about how we would be greeted as liberators. Fouad says, speculates about whether Iraq is one country or whether it can't cohere in the absence of a tyrant. I don't have his expertise in this, and I don't really have the right to a view. What I do have the right to, as an American citizen, is the view that when Vice President Cheney says we'll be greeted as liberators, when Secretary Wolfowitz says we won't need more troops, when the head of OMB says it won't cost very much, that if that's not bad intelligence and bad planning, I don't know what is.
No, that's very interesting. I mean, to answer David and to join him in one thing, I mean, as the cat said, I resemble these remarks. I personally said we would be greeted as liberators. And indeed, actually, what's interesting about Iraq, and that's the frustrating thing about, you know, what I, in this U.S. news piece that you saw, what I described as the duality of Iraq. Because of the insurgency in the Sunni Triangle, because of our helicopters being shot out of the sky, this is what we see. This is the truth that we see. Now, when I was in Iraq and Kuwait, someone humbled me with a remark, and he said, you know, we expected the Iraqis to be out receiving and greeting the Americans in the south of Iraq, principally the Shia, receiving them as liberators. And this person said, listen, these people were so broken, they were so defeated, they didn't have enough energy to swat the flies off their faces, let alone to go out and greet the Americans and greet them as liberators. There was enormous damage done to that country. Were we greeted as liberators? I think by and large we are. We were greeted as liberators. By and large, we were. Are we on friendly territory in the Shia South? I think we tend to be on friendly territory in the Shia South. Are we on friendly territory in the Kurdish North? We are on friendly territory in the Kurdish North. Now, this incident against the Italians, where 18 of them were killed in Nasiriyah, is in a Shia town. But these people who are doing these attacks, these are professionals. Either the remnants of the old regime or the jihadists who've converged on Iraq. I don't believe this business that this was Saddam's plan all along.
This is a story I just read from your account. I mean, but it's come from a U.S. military.
Yeah, people. I don't, I mean, you know, it's not my, I mean, my sense of it is as soon as we decapitated the army, as soon as we dismissed the army,
a mistake made by the Pentagon.
Yes, I mean, I can't. I mean, we can debate that. Whether, for example,
well, who made it then? I mean, who decided not to utilize? Because Garner recommended it,
right?
And that recommendation was changed.
I don't really know that piece of the puzzle.
Bremer came from Washington with orders to do it. Nobody will tell you, at least no one will tell me, who gave the order. nobody I ever interviewed
to believed, reverse the Garner recommendation.
To reverse General Garner's decision to use basically the bulk of the Iraqi army, that is,
who had floated away at the time of the war.
To bring them back together, to cashier everyone of colonel and above, but keep everybody else. Garner wanted to do that and use the army principally, as he said many times, including to me, as labor battalions. Bremer arrives. Within 2 weeks, he changes this order, and as a CIA official said to me on background, that was the day we made 450,000 enemies.
That is right.
Everybody agrees on that.
The army.
Even the administration agrees on that.
Absolutely.
Now, because that's what they're trying to rush to do, according to the president today.
No, totally. I mean, basically, the Iraqi army, the sociology of the army was very simple. The officer corps at the top were Sunni Takriti gangs, and the rank and file tended to be, for the most part, Shia, because the country is, for the most part, Shia. We could have definitely avoided the dismantling of the army and the making of this of this large number of enemies for ourselves.
I want to get to the insurgency, but this one last question. Suppose on day one after the toppling of the statue of Saddam,
right,
the height of the military victory, there had been a decision by the coalition forces to allow the United Nations and other member states of the United Nations to come in and share control over the change in governance. And to would that have made a dramatic difference?
Well, I'll tell you one way in which it would have made a dramatic difference. The late Sergio Vieira de Mello, someone I knew for a very long time, knew very well, knew more in his sleep about post-war reconstruction and turning governments, raising governments, than Paul Bremer, who is a terrorism expert, or General Garner, who is a missile defense expert turned humanitarian expert, ever did. I mean, one of the things that shocks me about the Bremer appointment, Fouad said, and I agree with him, that the military is doing a much better job than the civilian authority. The problem is the military isn't running things.
Right.
The civilian authority is. So again, bad. I mean, if the Pentagon was going to take over, then let them take over, not have people who are on 90-day contracts, who are revolving in and out. And excuse me, L. Paul Bremer, Jerry Bremer, doesn't know the first thing in terms of his professional experience about post-war reconstruction, about setting up governments, about being, to use Fouad's idea that makes me cringe so much,
the proconsul.
You know, to his Roman image, to be a proconsul. He has no experience. Sergio Vieira de Mello did. The UN does. That's just a fact. And it seems to be part of the hubris.
So what would have been the difference if, in fact, they brought the UN and listened to Sergio de Mello?
Would have helped. Might not have solved things. I don't think we disagree.
Because I want to get at this issue finally. There was this report, according to the New York Times and other papers, that the CIA said that many, an increasing number of Iraqis, you know, believe the insurgents can win, can kick the United States and the coalition partners out of the war. If that is a mindset, it makes a difference, does it not?
Well, remember, I mean, this is a poison culture, and if people are sitting watching Al Arabiya and Al Jazeera television.
Okay, let me make sure you understand. This is from the CIA, and in order, Bremer, I assume, had given it his approval. So
it does matter.
It's not coming from somebody outside.
Though I think David is right that it may not matter to the insurgency itself, perhaps, that we produce Saddam, we produce that shot as we had of his two sons. It will matter if we catch Saddam, because obviously, I mean, this man hovers over the life of this country. And maybe there are people who still believe that the Americans will cut and run, and that we will leave, and that the Sunni insurgents will come out and win in a show of force against the rest of the country. So, you know, if people believe this, that's where I think this insurgency have to be beaten back. And I think we go back to...
In other words, that's an unacceptable assumption.
We have to defeat... I mean, ultimately, we go back, like, what did... Early on, after the liberation of Iraq, I think the Americans they wanted to monopolize the power in Iraq. There is, of course, a new view today. For example, take the way we've treated the governing council. This is very interesting. We appointed a governing council. We chose 25 people. By and large, they are good people. By and large, they're good people. And then guess what we did? Then we said, we can't give them power. They're unelected. Well, of course they're unelected. We appointed them. I mean, it was amazing. We appointed them, and then we cut the ground from underneath them. And we left them without any specific mission as such. And we insisted on exercising power totally out of that Bremer palace. I mean, this was a mistake.
It is fair to say that for different reasons, you two have very different views about the consequences of Ahmed Chalabi in Iraq. Yes?
I suspect so. I don't know. We were talking before the program about Fouad's affection, but I don't know whether that means those are his political judgments.
No, I mean, look, there were 25, and then there was the assassination of one member of the governing council. There are 24 members. I think, by and large, I mean, if you take a look who the Kurds are, who the Shia are, who even the Sunnis are, though the Sunnis will have to they'll have to represent themselves. They have to separate themselves from the Takritis and the Fallujans and from the Saddamists if they are to find a way into the society. Now, I think Ahmed Chalabi is a patriot. I mean, that's my own sense of it. I have known him for a very long time. Did Ahmed Chalabi want us to go to Iraq? Of course he did. Did he want us to topple the regime? Of course he did. Did he think he could topple the regime on his own? Of course he didn't. And so we shouldn't really...
Well, but was he feeding information to people who were making decisions that was wrong would be the question. Not that he was a patriot, not that he didn't want the United States to come in. That is the question. Did he... choose information to give to the administration, and did the vice president then, see that information and come to certain conclusions, which he then reported to the president?
Well, I can't tell you about that, although I believe that to be the case. But what I can tell you is I've interviewed extensively people who served in the so-called Free Iraqi Forces, which largely construes itself as Ahmed Chalabi's militia, whether the Americans thought of it that way at the beginning or not. I mean, people went directly from the Free Iraqi Forces into being Iraqi National Congress officials in various towns. And I interviewed a number of these people, and these people all said to me, we thought we were going to run Iraq afterwards. So whether Ahmed Chalabi thought he could liberate Iraq by himself is one thing. He certainly seems to have thought he had a shot at ruling it. And Richard Pearl is on the record as saying that he thinks it would have been much better if we'd installed Ahmed Chalabi in power by American fiat. Talk about Roman gestures. I think that would have been a complete catastrophe. And in my experience on the ground, at least in Baghdad and down to Karbala, nobody has any time for Ahmed Chalabi. Certainly when he arrived in Nasiriyah, where the Italians were just killed, with his militia, no one paid the slightest heed to it. And American generals will tell you how shocked they were at the difference between obviously what they'd been told about his influence over Iraqis and what they witnessed themselves on the ground.
Well,
I want to limit my conversation about Ahmed Chalabi to come to this point. So what now?
Well, I think now...
How bad is it? And what has to be done?
Well, why should we declare it a failure? I mean,
I didn't declare it a failure. Right. I said, how bad is it? And what has to be done? That's not declaring a failure.
For one, I personally think, and I think you will check me on this one, because we talked about Iraq, and you were kind enough to have me here many times. I never believed that the weapons of mass destruction was our best-selling point. I never really believed he had them. I mean, I was not a weapons of mass destruction person. And now, despite a full briefing by David Kay when I was in Baghdad, we spent $300 million on the search for weapons of mass destruction. We came out empty. We have now given him another $1 billion, and we may come out empty. If you ask me, what should we do? There's a whole bunch of ways we can use $1 billion in Iraq. We could buy some of these missiles that are being fired at our helicopters. We could buy intelligence. We could buy loyalties. So I'm not a weapons of mass destruction person. We are beginning to adjust our expectations in Iraq, Charlie. There is a big correction underway.
You're saying that in a positive way.
Definitely. There's a big correction underway. And I think there's a contradiction in the policy, because if we are going to draw down our forces, this is a question which I think Senator McCain has put on the table in a very stark and dramatic way. If we're going to draw down our forces, then these large expectations for Iraq will not be sustainable, right? Because we can't draw down our forces and then expect all kinds of great things both in Iraq and
so you're saying if you draw down forces, it'll get worse.
Well, if we draw down our forces, we have to accept the logic of empowering the Iraqis much more forcefully and much more fully than we have up to date. We have to trust the Iraqis. We can't win this war without them. Charlie, what's the possibility that that an American from Missoula, Montana, or St. Louis, Missouri, or these young lieutenants and captains that one ran into, you know, some of the most decent people you will see, what's the possibility they'll be able to tell the difference between a Saudi and an Iraqi? None. The moment I open my mouth speaking Arabic in Iraq, people will know I'm Lebanese, that I'm not Iraqi. There are things which the Iraqis must do. There's intelligence which the Iraqis must provide. And for a number of months, the Americans did not trust
the Iraqis. So your point is that they came to that central conclusion in your belief.
There's no doubt. There's no doubt. What?
Later. Later than this.
Okay,
later.
Fine. No, they've corrected course.
Okay. Tell me, David, you just got back. How bad do you think the circumstances are in terms of the insurgency, you know, which we read every day of a significant act, the Italians being the latest, and what has to be done? And is it the simple answer that everybody seems to suggest, more Iraqis?
Well, I think it's a fine idea, but it won't work. The reason it won't work is to train a proper army to do the kind of work that people expect in Iraqization will require years, not a couple of months. You can't produce soldiers. You can give people uniforms and hand them an AK-47 assault rifle and give them a badge, but that doesn't make them soldiers. This whole idea of Iraqization is actually, in my view, a kind of guarantor that we'll either be out of there or with our tail between our legs have to hand it back to the UN. The Iraqization is a long process, and in any case, it's putting the cart before the horse. You need first to have political structures to which an army can be loyal, not an army around which you're going to build political structures. It's complete nonsense. It's one more fantasy lifeline that this administration has been clinging to, like the weapons of mass destruction, like this fantasy that not only would we be greeted as liberators, which we were, but that sense of thinking of us as liberators would simply last whatever we did. And that's the point. The point is, General Nash puts it, I quote him in my Times piece, is sure, they throw flowers at you the first day, but from the second day, you got to keep proving yourself, and we didn't. We sat around, which incidentally, General Abizaid and most of the military commanders will tell you, that is, we've been reacting all along. We have not taken matters into our own hands, and the principal way, if you can salvage this situation, and I'm by no means convinced it can be salvaged, nor am I as convinced in the benignity of the American occupation as Fouad, is not because I doubt that most of the people in the American forces are decent, but because being an occupation army under attack is a brutalizing thing, and cultural differences when one group is in charge and one group isn't creates all kinds of havoc. And even L. Paul Bremer, not my idea of a guy sufficiently alive to the realities of Iraqi life, has said on more than one occasion, it's no fun being occupied. And, you know, you can be as romantic as you like about American forces, but that hard truth of what it is to be an occupation army endures.
But I still didn't hear, David, what is your wisdom from having been there suggest has to be done?
If you want to salvage this situation, we have to on the one hand, make it the number one priority to create viable political structures and devolve political power to the Iraqis. And on the other hand, if we really mean to occupy Iraq by ourselves, ignoring the UN, ignoring multilateral structures, which I personally think is a mistake, but if that's what we mean to do, if that's what this administration wants to do, then we better bloody well double the number of troops there in the next 6 months. As General Shinseki, the Army Chief of Staff, warned and got his head handed to him by Paul Wolfowitz, and as Senator McCain has been arguing for.
Well, no one is going to come. I mean, I don't disagree with much of what David said, but no one really is going to come and pull our chestnuts out of the fire at this moment. I mean, no one. I mean, there are no foreign forces that are coming in. And we, in a prior discussion, we went over the Pakistanis, the Indians. Yeah. We even had
so it has to be American troops doing the security element and someone else organizing the political structure.
That's the only chance. I don't think it's much of a chance, but it's the only chance.
That's the only chance.
I think so.
Yeah.
But look, we inherited a very difficult mission. I mean, it's a very difficult assignment in a very difficult country, in a very difficult region. And we have put this imperium in an Arab country that even Arabs will tell you is a very difficult country. And this insurgency, this dark atavistic insurgency from the Sunni triangle, who would have predicted the fury of this?
That's what empires get, insurgency.
Right, if the Sunnis...
I mean, history's the only thing that would have predicted it.
Well, no, I don't think it's that easy to have, you know, predicted in advance. I mean, like what we said, people spend a lot of time worrying about what will the Shia do in the aftermath of liberation and in the new order. Well, what they've done is by and large reasonable.
Right.
By and large reasonable. What we were not ready for, and maybe we should have been ready for, but we didn't read it, that these people in one part of the country, the Sunni Arabs, who have governed Iraq for a very, very long time, their idea of normalcy is the acquisition of political power and the whip and terror. And they've lived off state terror, and they don't want to give it up. Now, if you tell me that we should have read all this in advance, I mean, that's a foresight that no one can have into a foreign and alien and distant society.
Frankly, reading of Thucydides, the Sicilian expedition, where the empire took a step too far, was really all you needed to read. You didn't have to be an expert in Iraqi history or Middle Eastern history or anything else. This is the fate of empires that overextend themselves. Fouad talks about putting an imperium in this dark, atavistic place. That's the price of empire. This, 70 attacks a day, between 35 and 70 attacks a day.
But this is
the price of empire.
I'm going over on this, but it seems to me, if you say you could read that and understand the price of empire, but in fact, this article you're about is how we botched it. Suppose we hadn't have botched it in your own magazine article, and suppose there were sufficient troops in there, and suppose there was an attitude of inclusion with respect to the United Nations and others, and a lessening of control, perhaps history would not have necessarily been true again, because perhaps it wouldn't be a question of an empire. It would have been a question of, for the first time, a transition of a country from a despot to its own governance.
I think this administration was never willing to share power in any serious way.
But that has to do with the administration, not some historical determinism about empires.
We'd still be losing a lot of soldiers on a lot of Iraqi streets for a very long time.
Which is the tragedy of it all.
Indeed.
Thank you, Fouad. Thank you, David.
Thank you.
We'll be right back. Stay with us. Bela Fleck is here. He first heard the banjo being played by Earl Scruggs for the theme of the Beverly Hillbillies television show. In 1989, he formed Bela Fleck and the Flecktones. The band combines elements of bluegrass, jazz, and funk. A winner of 7 Grammys, his new album is called Little Worlds. I am pleased to have him at this table for the first time.
Thank
Congratulations.
You. Nice to be here.
Well, you know what? I mean, people have said to me, one of our colleagues, and he pointed to this magazine, that Downbeat magazine, and he said, you're looking at a genius, and if you don't have him on the show, he can do things with a banjo that no one else has ever been able to do. That was sort of sold it for me.
Wow.
Right there.
Okay.
So,
does he work for us?
He works for me, actually, but loves you. Growing up, did you actually first hear Earl Scruggs on the Beverly Hills?
I did. I was a little kid, and I was in Queens, and I heard that Beverly Hillbillies theme, and I just thought that was the greatest thing that I had ever heard.
And therefore you wanted to play the banjo?
Well, I kind of forgot about it for a while. I remembered later, and when that Dueling Banjos came out, Deliverance,
all of that.
Boy, everybody knew what a banjo was then for a while, and so I got one. My grandfather got me one when I was 15. I was just about to start high school at Music and Art here in the city. And I went up to visit him in Peekskill, and he had this banjo for me, and not this one, but a banjo. And
What was it about the banjo? Was it the sound, or was it something else?
There's something about it. The sound is a very interesting sound. I think it's like kind of high tech and primitive at the same time. You know what I mean? So if you hear it, it's.
Speaking of the Beverly Hillbillies,
yeah. And so it's like there's speed and there's this technical stuff, but there's also this earthy quality. So I don't know, it's an interesting combination.
Give me an example of the earthy quality.
Well, I think about like the banjo coming from Africa, and then some of the Appalachian music has some of that sound. Yeah. has some of that mud quality or something. Some of that.
Is the banjo uniquely American?
Well, it's really from Africa originally.
Started there.
But I think when I think about what the banjo is, which is like a gourd, basically, with a hide head stretched over it and some kind of a wooden bridge, it's everywhere in the world. I've seen them in China. I've seen them in Africa. I've seen them in India. Yeah. You know, so there's some kind of a banjo in most places, just like there's usually a drum or some kind of guitar. Yeah.
But you've always had that. Have you always had this desire to play everything? I mean, not to be limited to one form or one genre?
Yeah, I've always loved... Well, growing up in the 60s and seeing just everything change through that period, I just thought that's what musicians were supposed to do, is, you know, stretch.
To do everything.
Well, just learn to keep changing and keep growing and keep learning to be a better musician. And even the Beatles were a big influence that way, because every time they put out a new record, they were trying something new. They were pushing into a new direction. But then as jazz started to change through the 70s, well, before that, and the fusion era and people like Chick Corea and... Yeah. You know, John McLaughlin. I was hearing all that stuff and all the progressive rock that was starting to happen then. So I just thought, you know, you're supposed to be, you know, growing and learning all the time.
Just name three or four people that would be at the top of the list in history who played the banjo.
Well, Eddie Peabody was a really, really well known at the four string strum style.
Yeah.
You know, Earl Scruggs is huge. You know, Earl Scruggs changed it for a lot of people, because I come at it through the bluegrass side, which is where he really transformed.
Which is what I knew in North Carolina,
Yeah, well, so, then you know, because that's home turf.
Exactly.
And one of my favorite banjo players and my teacher is a guy named Tony Trischka, who really was changing it a lot. There's a lot of guys in between, but he really put a spin on it that helped me move into where I've gone to.
Now, were you the first only kid you ever knew and who lived up at 110th Street here in Manhattan? Who loved the banjo more than any other musical instrument?
Yeah, it was pretty strange. And I went to high school in Harlem, you know, up in the City College campus on 135th Street, and it was pretty strange that I was bringing the banjo to school every day.
But what would they say?
Well, there was a lot of arm flapping, you know, because their main reference was either Deliverance or Beverly Hillbillies or the Hee Haw Show, which, you know, kind of put that sort of, I don't know, sort of cheesy spin on the banjo. But, you know, banjo has a long history, and it's been played a lot of different ways, and that's really a more recent development.
The whole what?
Even bluegrass is a more recent development. It's something that happened through the 40s and on up. But if you go back to the history of the banjo, back from the slaves building them here, and then banjo being, like, the most popular instrument in the late 1800s, you know, the way guitar has become... It was, and all kinds of music was played on it in those days, and some of the first recordings were made by these guys. They called them the Banjo Kings, and it was an instrument they thought would record well.
Have there been sort of highs and then sort of leveling out in terms of enthusiasm for the banjo?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it kind of had melted away, and then this huge revival happened when Earl Scruggs picked up the banjo. Suddenly it was, and they called him the Paganini of the banjo.
Paganini of the banjo.
In the New York Times when he played at Carnegie Hall. So he was really...
Played it like a violin.
Bringing it back, he really played it like a banjo. Like, I mean, because I think he wouldn't really ever have played classical music, but there were guys that way before him who were forgotten by then who actually had. So it's an interesting phenomenon.
You compose as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What brings you the most satisfaction, playing or composing?
All of it, really. I mean, I love interacting with musicians, and I like that. Sometimes some of the things that I've done recently, which take a lot of practicing and careful sculpting, and then you have to play it just like that. Like, for instance, a concerto that I was working on with my friend Edgar Meyer, or playing classical music, is very stressful because you have no choice. You have to play it just like that, or you're wrong. Where when you're improvising, there's a lot of things that are on the line between wrong and great.
Show me the instrument. I mean, give me a sense of, what makes it what it is and what the things you can do on it.
Sure. Well, of course, you've got what we talked about. So we've got that sort of things. But I'm doing some classical stuff lately. I do it better. You're making me nervous.
Oh, I'm sorry. Because I'm...
Okay. No, it's not you, it's me. But... there's a lot of possibilities. It can be really pretty. It can be really evocative.
And who makes up the band, the Plexstones?
Victor Lamont Wooten is our bass player, and a guy by the name Future Man plays the electronic drum guitar that he invented called the Synthax Drumitar, and Jeff Coffin.
And here is you and the Plexstones performing Scratch and Sniff from Live at the Quick, which is on this DVD. Here it is, roll tape. In it. Who else joins you? Is this Bobby McFerrin is in this?
Yeah, he is on it.
Yeah, and
he's on
Brandon Marsalis is on it.
Bramford is on some stuff. Yep. Yeah. A lot of people you might not have heard of. A great theremin player named Pamela Kirsten.
Yeah.
Paul Brantley on the cello. Some wonderful Indian percussionists. Chinese singer that we met in a Chinese restaurant. Heard her singing in the back room.
And said, come join us on this album.
A band called Nickel Creek is on it with us, and the Chieftains, and a lot of really wonderful musicians.
Yeah. Where can you take it? I mean, the sense of where you are, do you, the better you get and the more brilliant you get, does it offer you more possibilities?
It does.
In terms of what you think you can do?
Well, yeah. Yeah. Both as an improviser and trying to write, there's so much, well, there's so much inspiration out there, too, when you start getting into jazz and classical music and Indian music and all the different things out there. There's a lot of places that the banjo actually fits into pretty well, surprisingly well. Like, it sounds good with a string quartet, or it sounds good, you know, in a piano duo, you know, or things like
that. Are you asked frequently to play with piano duos or with a string quartet?
No, but I might get away with it on a record. I might try it with somebody and find out, wow, it's a nice combination. And what's fun about the banjo is that most of the things haven't been heard before, so I kind of get to try things and it feels like the first time sometimes.
If it wasn't the banjo, what would it be for you? What instrument?
Well, I don't know. It's hard for me to, after 30 years of playing, to imagine playing anything else. I mean, I still love it. I still love the way it sounds and the whole process of trying to improve on it, write on it.
But are many young people coming into playing the banjo?
More and more. Yeah, I'm seeing a lot of people come to the shows. A lot of times they have banjos to sign and stuff like that, and they say that they started playing, you know, after they heard us. Or it's pretty cool. We got to do some things with a huge band, the Dave Matthews Band.
And oh, sure. Dave Matthews Band has been on this program 3 or 4 times.
Yeah, and that brought us a lot of attention. You know, we have to thank those guys for exposing us to their audience. So we have a lot of kids coming now. It's really cool.
So you played with them, or they brought you on stage when they were touring to play with them? Or?
Well, we would open the show, and then they'd bring us all out to play, and sometimes we would end up playing
join with
a 45-minute song or something.
Wow.
They were very, very giving to us, and it's unusual.
Now, does that come from their, you know, they've got, what's the guitarist, who is the guitarist for the
band? Dave Matthews,
No, 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 for Dave Matthews' band, Boyd.
The fiddle player, Boyd Tinsley,
Boyd Tinsley, right.
Yeah, well, I think part of it is Victor and Future Man, who are brothers, rhythm section. They knew a lot of those guys
from
in Virginia.
Charlottesville. Yeah,
exactly. So they were in Newport News, which is not far, and their home. There's 5 brothers altogether, so their home was like a musical gathering place for people from all around Virginia. Yeah. So everybody kind of knew about them, and then I guess some of those guys used to come hear me back when I was in Newgrass Revival, which was a progressive bluegrass band that I was in for a long time. So then they invited us to play some openings shows with them, and then they just kept inviting us back. It was really cool.
You play around the world?
Yeah.
Where is it extremely popular, the banjo?
The banjo?
Other than, I assume, Africa because of its heritage. Europe?
people like it whenever they hear it, but in terms of, well, in Ireland they have their own banjo styles, and there's that. Germany has a different kind of banjo thing.
Called the same thing, or
yeah, but I mean they do more, almost more, strum kind of banjo styles, and stuff. But I'm trying to think of a place, if there's a particular place where people just love. You know what one spot is the Czech Republic.
Really?
Yeah. And for a long time, that was, the banjo was like, represented freedom to a lot of those people.
Yeah, Vaclav Havel and the rest of them, yeah.
So there was a lot of bluegrass bands and a lot of progressive bluegrass bands there. When I finally got over there to play, I was surprised that people knew who I was, so.
Wow. This Bela Fleck and the Flecktones, 10 from Little Worlds is this CD. Thank you for coming.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
Thank you for joining us. See you next time. Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
Coca-Cola and our local bottlers have sponsored more than 4,000 scholars, like Matthew Turner, helping them to attend college and prepare for careers that benefit all of us. Satisfying a thirst for achievement, the Coca-Cola Company.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
We are PBS.
The next Charlie Rose, a conversation with Gore Vidal, the great novelist and essayist, about his book Inventing a Nation. Also, Jane Pauley. Join us.